Christ. The Lord be with you.
And also to you.
Amen, amen, amen. I have just a few announcements. Can I have a little more gain on this, please? And then I'm going to turn it over to Bill Small. Happy anniversary to me. Today is the first Sunday in the year. And I began at this church as pastor the first Sunday of the year, 2014. So today is my 7th anniversary as your pastor. I'll be celebrating all month, just simply thinking about what God has done in these 7 years. I thank you for the privilege of serving you as your pastor. The 7 years have flown by. Yes, even the fire department is celebrating. Thank you, Bill. Your stewardship envelopes are ready. You'll see changes in them. Perhaps the virus has forced and helped us implement what I've wanted to do for a while, and that is go to one offering. Your offering envelope will now include spaces on there for you to designate your stewardship, or rather your Samaritan Fund contribution for the first Sunday and your Deacon's Fund contribution for the third Sunday. So we need not take a separate offering. You can put both offerings in your envelope, in that one envelope, the tithes and the offerings and your special first and third Sunday offerings. I also remind you that there is in your box of envelopes an envelope called per capita apportionment. This is the portion of our income that we give to the presbytery in order for them to do their work of helping our churches. This is a Presbyterian tax, if you will. We pay to the presbytery a certain amount every year based on the number of members we have, and your portion of that which we pay to the presbytery is $27. I have mine already ready to go this morning. And then we're also asking you to give a small extra $2 to help offset the printing of the envelopes themselves. And I have that ready to go this morning. I hope that you are continuing to honor your commitments. And in fact, let me thank you for the way we closed out 2020. We closed it out not in a great deficit position, not wondering if we're going to be able to still keep the lights on. You have been faithful, keeping up your promises, your pledges, your agreements, your covenants, whatever way you want to term it. Thank you for continuing to support this ministry and continuing to give your tithes and offerings to the Lord's work. The Lord be praised. This Thursday, there'll be pastoral teaching via Zoom. We'll be looking at Psalm 119, verses 25 through 32. Those are all my announcements. Bill Small, please.
Good morning. As you know, we typically have a food distribution on the second Saturday of each month. In January, it is different. So we're going to have a distribution on the third Saturday of the month. That'll be on January 16th. So please make that note on your calendar, the third instead of the second Saturday. So please, if you can come to help, be here at 9 o'clock on Saturday, January 16th. The church has changed how we send out internet information. Particularly, there have been a lot of emails over the past few days and few weeks in terms of prayer requests. So if you're not receiving emails or if you have not received an invitation to join a new method to receive emails specifically from Crossroads Church at groups.io, that was sent out on December 14th. So if you're not getting emails or if you don't remember getting that invitation, which is important to respond to, or if you know somebody else that might not have gotten that, please respond or check in with the church office. You can call the office or you can email the office to make sure you're registered in this new format to receive emails and that you don't miss out. Crossroads Church at groups.io sent out on December 14th. Finally, when you pulled in this morning through the porte-cochere, you would have gotten your communion cup. There's also the opportunity to pick up your offering envelopes. Right now they're inside, but we're going to try to bring a table out and put the offerings out here in the sidewalk. So after the service, if you've not had a chance to pick up your envelopes, please do so, so that you can be prepared for the rest of the year. That's all the announcements I have. We're going to have a call to worship. It's a responsive call to worship. I'm not sure how I'll hear you. I'll just take it by faith. But if you want to roll your window down and stick your head out and shout it, that'd be fine. This is from the bulletin. I don't know what the scripture reference is. People of the world, it is time to celebrate new beginnings.
We step into the new year with faith.
People of faith, it is time to look ahead in hope.
We step into the unknown with hope.
People of hope, it is time to walk in the footsteps of Jesus.
We step forward together as God's family.
Amen.
And as God's family, we're going to sing, Another Year is Dawning.
God to whom we make our confession is the God who loved us so much that he took on mortality, choosing to limit the divine in order to understand us and to be with us. Trusting in that love, let us make our confession together in unison with the prayer in your bulletin. O Lord God, We confess that we have done what is wrong and displeasing in your sight. O Lord, help us to face the truth when we ignore those in need and those who have been stricken with poverty and are facing the injustices that come along with it. We ask for your forgiveness when we pretend that all is right with the world. Give us the ability to recognize your Son and our brothers and sisters far and near. Make us witnesses that love exists and is alive, and that you, the God of love, exist and are alive now and forevermore. Amen. Hear the good news from Isaiah 53, verse 6. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of all of us. Amen.
Amen.
Let us continue in our worship. Let us remember. Let us look back and see what he's brought us from. So let's lift our voices and sing. I won't let a day go by without praising his name. In Calvary, the blood that gives me strength from day to day will never lose its power.
Jesus shed for me.
The homegoing of their beloved aunt. I flew to Norfolk, Virginia to participate in the service for that aunt last week. So please be in prayer for the Walkers. You see other needs before you: Audrey Godfrey, Mark Brown, Dorothy Johnson, Michael Hairston. Some of these folks are with us today. They still are in need of our prayers, ongoing prayers. Sharonda Blake, Jasmine, Febra Clark's niece, Warwick and Catherine Christie, John Gregory, Alberta and Laverne Settles, Isaac Wood, Gracie Floyd, Dolores Lewis, Doreen Wanless, whom I visit every Monday, is comfortable as she is mostly in the bed. She's pretty much bedridden these days. Dennis Morgan, Febra Clark, Edward and Evelyn Patterson. Now we want to be in prayer for those who are doing their grief work. The family of Ron Heber, Maggie Stewart and Clyde McClendon, Annette Smith, and again Vanessa and Mel Walker. I want to invite you to pray there in your own space, using your own words to our God. Then it will be my joy to lead us. Let us pray. O God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come, our shelter from the stormy blast and our eternal home, we come to thee. Before the hills in order stood or earth received her frame, from everlasting thou art God, to endless years the same, we come to thee. Thank you for your consistency. You are ever the same. You are the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. And we praise you for the stability we know because you do not change. We come to thee, for in ourselves and of ourselves and by ourselves, we are not able to address the ills, the circumstances, the problems that come our way. But in thee and with thee, we are mighty and we receive strength. We come to thee and thank you for your power, for your might. We would stand with these whose names have been called. Thank you that you knew them before we knew them. You knew their circumstances before we knew their circumstances. You knew their pain before they had a pain. I pray your merciful touch on their bodies, on their circumstances. Pray that you touch their doctors, they're therapists, they're rehab specialists, they're ambulance drivers, they're caregivers. Anyone around them, I pray that you would anoint them to do good and do them no harm. We stand with these who have walked through a valley of tears, these who have had to say good night to a loved one, see you in the morning. We pray that you would continue to console, to comfort. We pray in the strong name of Jesus. We pray for this church and its ministries. We thank you for each other. We thank you for this community in which you have placed us. Grant that we may be good for our community, that we may serve them, that we may continue to find out their greatest needs and try to meet them. We thank you for the opportunity to proclaim Jesus, their greatest need. We also pray that as we look at social services and community outreach, you teach us what to do and creative, winsome ways in which to do it, that we might deliver the gospel in many different ways, the truth, the love of Jesus to our neighbors. Help us, we pray, as we try to find the right way, the best way, the most effective way to reach those that you've given us right here in our neighborhood. Thank you for our leaders. Thank you for those who support this ministry in every way. I pray that you continue to speak to us and help us not to be discouraged, not to become cynical during these very difficult days. May we continue to rejoice that you have spoken, that you are speaking, that you will continue to speak to your people gathered in your name, studying your word, meeting you in prayer. As we gather to thee, speak to us, we pray, in the strong name of Christ. Finally, we would pray for our country, for this upcoming election on Tuesday. Grant wisdom to every voter. Grant a dignity to every person running, that whether they win or lose, they might be gracious in defeat or victory. We pray for sitting leaders, those who are leaving office soon, those who are being sworn in today in Washington. We pray that you would grant to every lawmaker, every servant, every politician, a mindset that is set on service. Grant that we may serve the citizens of our country. Pray for the President of these United States, the Governor of the State of Georgia, the Mayor of the City of Atlanta, and every other leader in our country, that you would give wisdom all their days. We give you thanks, O Lord, that you have kept us during a most difficult year. Thank you for the privilege of having crossed over into a new year. We bless you. We missed seeing each other on December 31st at midnight, but you were with us. We weren't with each other, but we were with thee. We thank you for bringing us thus far. Now have your way in us. We look forward to whatever you have in store for us in this year. To thee we give praise and thanks. In the strong name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we are bold to pray. Amen.
This is the first Sunday of the month, and actually the first Sunday of a new year. What do we call first Sundays at Crossroads? Boy, that was weak. Family Sundays. One of the ways we celebrate being family is who we are. And one of the ways that we can do that is to recite together the Apostles' Creed. So let's do that together and remind us who we are and why we are who we are. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Again, thank you for your gifts, especially as we close the year. We simply give thanks to God for what he has allowed us to do. I have seen a revolution in my personal financial picture, and I hope you have as well. As we continue to honor the Lord, he expands and multiplies our meager resources so that we're able to do more than we thought we could do. God the giver, we thank you for these resources you have entrusted to us. As we give, we do so with grateful hearts. With cheerfulness, we return a portion of your gifts that Crossroads Church may care for the financially distressed, spread the gospel to the nations, address economic and political injustices, create and sustain ministries that develop disciples of Jesus the Christ. As we give, we pray that you, Holy God, would teach us how to give. May our motives be pure, our hearts be glad, and our hands be open. We pray in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Father, we thank you for the privilege of giving to you. We thank you that you give us lives and resources and hearts that we can respond to you. And so, Father, we pray that you would take these offerings, these gifts, these tithes, and take our lives and use them to glorify your name. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
nationwide in the Presbyterian denomination, the PCUSA, of which we are a part, there is an initiative called the Matthew 25 Initiative, where they're asking churches to consider becoming a Matthew 25 church. And over the next weeks, I'll be explaining just what that means biblically, theologically. I want to look at, we'll need those guys to be a little quieter down there. I can hear you up here. I want to look at Matthew 25, and I want to get five messages out of this passage. This one, some people call it a parable. It really is not a parable, but rather a teaching of Jesus. Beginning in Matthew 25, the passage at which I'm going to look over the next weeks is contained in verses 31 down through 40. However, today, or down through 42 rather, I am going to begin this series by just looking at 31 to 33. And actually the passage goes down through the end of the chapter, 31 to 46. But I'm gonna break it up into bite-sized pieces. So for today, I want to look at Matthew 25, verses 31 to 33, and I read from the New King James Version of the Scriptures. Jesus is speaking. Matthew 25, 31. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the holy angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them one from another as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. And he will set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. That's all I want to read for today. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Eternal God, as we peer into your word for these next few minutes, would you please grant us insight and wisdom we could not possibly have on our own? Speak, O Lord, we pray. Amen. Had seemingly endless discussions during my collegiate years about the social gospel versus the biblical gospel. We talked about that a lot. In short, there were those who believed that our ministry should be focused on preaching Jesus and having people make a decision and people get saved. That's what preaching is about. That's what ministry is about, that and only that. And there were others who believed that we needed to address the societal ills that were all around us, poverty and education and childcare and housing and a whole host of problems that plagued every community in which a church was set. There were some who said we need to only preach the Bible and we don't need to worry about having feeding programs, and there were others who said, yeah, but a hungry person can't even hear the gospel if their stomach is rumbling. Ideally, our ministry should focus on proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ in hundreds of ways, in thousands of ways, packaging that one glorious message in a variety of ways. And maybe the best way to do that is through the portal of a feeding program or a literacy program or a clothing distribution initiative. I want to look at this passage, and for today, simply want to note the very important idea here that Jesus proffers he talks about coming in that final day and separating the people into two groups. He's got distinctions. It's fashionable in cultural dialogue to eradicate distinctions. We shouldn't have any divisions of any kind. You've heard it. Phrases such as, well, we're all the same. Or, there's only one God, right? Or, it doesn't matter what you believe as long as you're sincere. Or, there's only one race, the human race. Or, I don't see color, I just see people. Well, Jesus never subscribes to that line of reasoning. Jesus never suggests for a minute that all humanity is the same. He draws, in this passage, a distinction. Did you see it? Between kinds of people. Look at the text. Some people are sheep, and some people are goats. And when he comes, he's going to separate the people into groups, because in the mind of Jesus, we are not all the same. Some are compliant. Some are non-compliant. New Testament scholar R.T. France, in his commentary on the Gospel of Matthew, says that division has been a key theme in this gospel ever since chapter 24, verse 38, which reads, For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day Noah entered the ark. There's a division. Yeah, we're not all the same. We're not all in the ark. We're not all outside the ark. There's some in, some out. It's still the same today. I was rereading a series of parables in chapter 13 of Matthew. You need to read it sometime, maybe this week. I highly recommend the parables in Matthew 13. In those parables, there is clear teaching, and I never saw it this way until I started working on this sermon, but I never saw Matthew 13 as a series of parables that remind us that we're not all the same. There is the parable of a sower who goes out to sow seed, and the seed falls on, listen to this, different kinds of soil. We're not all the same. Some soil is receptive, some is not receptive. We're not all the same, that parable reminds us. The parable that follows that one is a parable in which a sower sows good seed in his field, and while he is sleeping, his enemy comes and sows tares in with the wheat. And the wheat and the tares grow together until harvest, at which time they are separated. The wheat and the tares are separated because we're not all the same. Distinction, division, particularity. Did you hear it? There are categories. We're not all lumped together. There's a stark contrast between this teaching of Jesus and our national discourse, in which people are trying to say there really are no differences. We're all just one big, glorious country. No, we're not. We're a country full of different kinds of people. I want to begin this thinking about being a Matthew 25 church with reminding us that the church is a distinctive organism with a distinctive mission and mandate. We are not all the same. All organizations are not the same. Listen to Jesus. Go and make disciples of all nations. He didn't say that to every group. He said that to the church. We're distinct. We're the only organism in the world given this mandate. Now go into the world and change it. Not all organizations are the same. Not all people are the same. Clearly, the church has something different to say, something different to sing, something different to teach, something different to preach. We are not like everybody else. There are sheep and there are goats. There are obedient disciples and disobedient disciples. There are holy people, there are unholy people. There are folks dressed in and living in white, and there are folks dressed and living in darkness. There are people on the right, and there are people on the left. Did you see it in our text? When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the holy angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory, and all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them one from another. Oh, clearly they're not all the same. Just like a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats, and he will set the sheep on his right hand and the goats on the left. Before we can talk about being a Matthew 25 church, let us remember that we're not all lumped together. There is a people God is going to use, his sheep. We are not his goats, we are his sheep. And he will separate us from the others, and he will use us in a distinctive way. In a blog post titled, "We've Got to Stop Lumping All Asian Americans Together," Valet Vero wrote about the frustration she feels. She is a Hmong woman. The Hmongs are an ethnic group that have never had a country of their own. The Hmong people are an Asian ethnicity. She said that she is commonly seen as simply Asian. And she writes, "I was seen as the Asian girl first and foremost, assumed to be great at math and science, high performing and musically inclined. But those stereotypes didn't describe me." Later in the post she wrote, "We are seen as one big subgroup, Asian, and little to no differentiation is given beyond that. The invisibility of being lumped into the, quote, model minority myth hurts newer Asian Pacific Islander, Asian American Pacific Islander students and perpetuates the inability of schools to meet our individual educational needs," end of quote. We don't simply have Asians in the world. No, we have distinctions, particularity. We have Koreans and Japanese and Chinese and Thai and Filipino and many others. There are distinctions in ethnicities, in culture, and there are distinctions in theology. Did you hear it? Our text says Jesus will separate one from another. Now be cautious. As we go through this teaching of Jesus in Matthew 25, it is going to be very tempting to assume that if we do enough good works, we can earn God's commendation. All I have to do is feed the hungry and give drink to the thirsty and visit the prisoner, and I shall indeed hear God say, "Well done." Believers do good work not in order to get saved. We do good work because we are saved. No one has ever gotten saved because they did a lot of good deeds. You do not earn salvation by your work. However, Jesus will say, "I expect to see good work out of you because you are mine." Ephesians 2:10 says we were created to do good work, but we were not saved by our work. Ephesians 2:8. Understand how we go at this passage. We go at it celebrating the fact that Jesus Christ is alive and calls us to partner with him to address the world. and yes, even to address its ills. Did you see the states of need, the categories of need in the text? There are hungry people needing food. We'll see that later on in the text. There are thirsty people needing drink. There are strangers needing taking in. The Tyndale version of the New Testament has for this line, I was harborless and ye lodged me. There are naked people needing clothing. There are sick people needing visitation. There are people in prison needing visitors. And addressing these needs should never be done with a let me show God I'm a good person kind of attitude. Rather, we address the needs of the hungry, the thirsty, the homeless, the naked, the sick, the incarcerated from a distinctly theological vantage point. We go into those settings in the name of Jesus, representing Jesus, and we celebrate our distinction. I am a person of God. I remember being at a gas station some years ago, and there was a woman who apparently had been living in her car. Her car was stacked with clothing, and you could see through the windows of the car, clothing and personal care items, and she said, I'm trying to get some gas. I only have a couple of dollars. And I said to her, if Jesus were here, he would fill your tank. I represent Jesus. And I filled her tank. And I bid her a good day, and I went on. I'm trying to figure out how we can do that more consistently, not just occasionally. How do we find the need and fill it, but fill it differently, fill it with distinction because we are the people of God? We're not only God's people, we are God's sheep. We are the followers of the Good Shepherd. We are God's right-hand people. You saw in this text, verse 33, that when Christ shall come, he will separate the people. Some he'll put on his right and some on his left. The right hand is always the hand of favor. The sheep will be on his right. The goats will be on his left. The left is the side of disfavor. We serve from a right hand point of view. We are not only God's people, we are God's right hand sheep. We are the followers of the Good Shepherd. We serve people in the name of Jesus with distinction, as if we belong to a special category. We're not lumped with everybody. There are many organizations that feed the hungry. Feeding America, Meals on Wheels, Action Against Hunger, The Hunger Project. There are organizations that provide water. Water.org, WaterAid, Water is Life, Pure Water for the World. Around the world, there are hundreds of organizations that are committed to humanitarian relief. Oxfam International, World Vision, the Red Cross, International Rescue Committee, World Jewish Relief. Good organizations doing good work in the world. So how do we differ from them? What is the advantage of being a Matthew 25 church? Why would we describe ourselves as that? Why don't we just say, well, you know, we're just trying to do good in the community. What is the idea of a Matthew 25 organism? How do we differ from World Relief or World Jewish Relief or World Vision? How do we differ? I'm glad you asked. And with this, I close. We do everything we do from the vantage point of being God's people, God's set apart people, God's consecrated saints. We remember every day that we are his sheep, and we do all we can to maintain that distinction, not deny it. We are something else. We are someone's else. We do not do what everybody does. We do not serve with the mindset that everybody else serves with. We serve from a unique perspective out of our calling. We, the sheep, represent the shepherd. That is the difference. In our deeds and in our words, we proclaim Christ as we feed the hungry, visit the prisoner. Listen to verse 33 again of Matthew 25. And he will set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. You remember Psalm 100, verse 3, don't you? I'll just celebrate the last clause of 100, verse 3 in the Psalter. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Amen. Let us pray. Holy God, who has called us to be thy sheep, who follow the shepherd, we give you thanks. And we confess that in our eagerness to make a difference in our world, we have sometimes left you out and just simply done our work in human energy, not remembering to call you in, to invoke your anointing on our work. Forgive us, we pray, and teach us what it is to serve and minister with distinction. We pray for those who have not separated themselves from the world who is too much with us, those who have not separated themselves unto you, who've not stepped away or out of the crowd and heard your distinctive call to be yours. We pray for them. Grant to us a great desire to live Christianly, to live as disciples. Help us, O Lord our God. In the name of your Son, Jesus, the Good Shepherd, we pray. Would you please remain in an attitude of prayer for just a moment? Perhaps you are here today, you're listening to us, you're listening to this recording, viewing this later. Perhaps you're right here this Sunday morning in our parking lot, and you'd have to say, Pastor Farmer, I don't feel different at all. I'm not separated from the goats. I don't sense any uniqueness or distinction about me, about my life. That might be because you have not dealt squarely with your sin and with where you stand before God. If you're like everybody else, it might be because you've not had a serious conversation with the God who is not like every other deity. The God who made you, the God who sent his Son for you. Would you just pray this prayer with me if that describes you? O God, my Creator, you have created me to have a relationship with you. Today I open my heart, my mind, my whole being to you. I renounce my trying to run my own life. I submit to you creator, sender of Jesus. Jesus, I open my heart to you. Forgive me my sin. I renounce my commitment to sin. I commit myself to you this day. Teach me your ways, O Lord. I thank you. Amen. Me, I would love to have a conversation with you about what that means, how you follow that up with a whole new life. Would you please call me at our church, 770-469-9069, or email me, richardallenfarmer1951@gmail.com. I promise you a speedy response. Let's talk. Amen. Let us prepare to remember our Lord, who gave himself for us and for our sin. I trust that you have received a communion kit. If you have not received the communion elements, would you simply flash your lights or even honk your horn and an usher will serve you. Make sure that you have the communion elements. I think we all received them as we came in. But if you have not, just take a minute, make sure everyone has been served. Is there anyone who has need of a communion element kit? Please honk your horn or flash your lights. Let us see you. We'll make sure you get that. I see lights on there. Are you needing service there? Are those just running lights? Your car is on with your heater going, maybe.
Do you need one?
Do they need something? Patience? Mm-hmm. Oh, you're taking care of it. Okay. I see only one set of headlights there, I think. I'm not sure. I flashed them a couple of times if you need our help. If some of you may just simply have your lights on because they're your regular running lights. You've got your heater going. But if you need communion elements, just flash them once or twice. So see, okay, I don't see any flashing lights. All right, I think we're good. All right. I want to read from Paul's letter to the church at Corinth. All right, yes, I see. I think that's Claudette Clark. I see it. Patience, down from you, there's a red Lexus SUV. I saw flashing, I think. Yes, okay, yes. No, that one was flashing their lights. To read from Paul's letter to the church at Corinth, chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Would you please take the bread in hand and let us be reminded of the sacrifice of our Lord in our behalf. Oh, great God, we thank you for sending Jesus Christ for us. We thank you for him who modeled sacrifice and giving of himself for another. May we imitate him Oh Lord Jesus, thank you for your life, for your body broken at Calvary in our behalf. We praise thee, oh Lord Jesus. Amen. Beloved, the body of our Lord Jesus. Paul continues writing, in the same manner he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. This cup represents not only our past, the fact that Jesus would give himself at Calvary. This represents our future. For Jesus said, I will not drink this cup again with you until I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. This represents not only what Christ has done, but oh, bless his name, this represents what he shall do. Beloved, the blood of Christ poured out for us all. Drink it and rejoice. Amen. Close our time singing Faith is the Victory that Overcomes the World. And immediately after the benediction, those of you who are visitors, not members of the Crossroads Church, are free to leave, and then members, please remain in your cars, because just after a few minutes we're going to give people a chance to exit the parking lot. Then we will have our annual meeting. It will not be very long. You'll be home way before 6 o'clock. Let's see. Every Now, beloved, my dearly beloved, go forth in the name of our God, who has called us to distinction. God be praised for this bright new year and this bright Sunday morning. May the Lord keep you and bless you and enable you to live the kind of lives of which you've only dreamed. May God put his strength in you and help us to live like sheep and not like goats. All for the glory of his name. And the people said, amen. Amen. Bless you. Have a great day.